Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the Fate Master. I'm FateMaster Cesium. That's my YouTube handle. And today we're going to do episode 2 of my Dresden Childlings Fate Core game. And you may recall in the last game, only one of the two players in the game was able to make it, and that happened again for episode 2. My friend Beth could not come, so I ran episode 1 just for my friend Rob, and I did the same for episode 2, and today I'm going to summarize episode 2. So the last episode was titled The Gallows Letter, and it was sort of a sixth sense kind of story where the young orphaned Artie David, 11-year-old kid detective with death sight, with the ability to see dead people, encounters a ghostly hanged man and a ghostly Wells Fargo delivery man, whom it wasn't obvious that he was ghostly until the end. That was the big reveal. That was sort of like akin to the big reveal in The Sixth Sense when we find out that spoiler alert, if you haven't seen The Sixth Sense, turn the volume off so you can't, and I'll cover my mouth so you can't read my lips, that Bruce Willis was actually, his character was actually a ghost. So it was the same sort of thing. So we pick up with episode 2, and episode 2 is titled The Malocchio. And if you don't know what the Malocchio is, it's something from Italian folklore. I happen to be of Italian-American ancestry. And in southern Italy, there is this superstition called the Malocchio, the evil eye. The word Malocchio literally means the evil eye. Mal means bad, and occhio is eye. So I decided, and again, I was expecting Rob and Beth to show up. So I had prepared, you know, I had kept my original idea for a story. I was prepared to run that, and then when I found out that Beth again was not going to be able to make session 2, I had to come up with something off the top of my head, and that was the Malocchio. I really kind of did it by the seat of my pants, just drawing on superstitious folklore from my own heritage. So the episode 2 of the Malocchio opens up in the middle of the night, and young Artie David is awakened from slumber in his bed inside his cell, his room at the St. Mary Magdalene de Pazzi orphanage in Runehaven, Maryland, by the sounds of a raucous party outside. He went to his window, and he saw across the churchyard bright supernatural light emanating from all the windows of one house in the neighborhood, from whence the laughter and noise seemed to be emanating. He dressed and sneaked out of the orphanage to investigate, traveled across the churchyard to the residences and to the house, and he peeked in the window, seeing an intoxicated old lady drinking homemade wine and reveling with dozens of ghosts. One of these ghosts, dressed in the ghostly, anachronistic apparel of a peasant farmer, poked his ethereal head through the closed door of the house, regarded Artie, kind of looked him up and down, and then returned inside where Artie could see through the window. The ghost spoke to the old lady in what sounded like Italian. From a glass ornament of blue, black, and white concentric circles that Artie spotted hanging from the dining room chandelier as he peered through the window of the house, he felt a disturbing glare upon him as the eye-like charm seemed to stare back at him. Now, if you've never seen a Malocchio charm, you can look it up on, on Google Images. If I had the technical know-how, I would superimpose a picture of the Malocchio. And maybe as time goes by, I'll learn how to do that kind of stuff. But that's what this is. It's a Malocchio charm. So Artie returned to the orphanage, and he climbed back into bed, and he went back to sleep. The next morning, the story picks up in Artie's penmanship class at the orphanage. The class is disturbed by the gleeful ruckus of some boys out in the churchyard. Sister Bernard Mary, who was inspired by my own seventh grade math teacher, Sister Bernard, moved to the window to get a better look, and Artie followed behind her, encouraging the rest of the class to get up and swarm the window to observe the disturbance. Outside, two mischievous boys were trying to throw a pair of old sneakers, shoelaces knotted together, over the convent's gateway arch to entangle them there. I don't know if you did this in your neighborhood where you grew up, but where I grew up in South and Southwest Philly, when we were finished with a pair of sneakers, if we outgrew them or they got a hole in the sole or something, we would tie the shoelaces together and make a game of it. We'd try to throw them and entangle them around the telephone wires. So, and you could see if you went through my neighborhood, you would see these sneakers hanging from the telephone wires everywhere you went. It was an eyesore, but you know, we were kids. What the heck did we care? We didn't know better. Or we knew better. We knew we shouldn't do it, but we did it anyway. So these two boys are doing that with the gated archway over the convent's yard. So from the classroom, Sister Bernard opened the window and chased them away. As Sister Francesca and her class in the room next door came in to see what all the noise was about. One of the mischievous boys gave them all the obscene double bird hand gesture. I'm not going to do it, but you know what I mean. While the other boy furrowed his brow and shot a sinister glare in their direction. Well, recognizing that sinister glare as the dreaded Malocchio, or evil eye, Sister Francesca, one of the nuns in the orphanage, one of the teachers in the orphanage who happens to be of Italian descent, responded with a desperate warding mano cornudo. Now, I can't do the mano cornudo. It's a hand gesture, but because I can't touch these two fingers together. But if you practice enough, apparently you can. And the mano cornudo, or horned hand — that mano means hand and cornudo means horned in Italian — if you can do that, you can ward off the evil eye. That's the mano cornudo. So Sister Francesca, she desperately did the mano cornudo gesture, and then Mother Superior suddenly arrived in the classroom, hearing all of this disturbance and the kids, and sternly admonished Sister Francesca for this sort of pagan superstitious gesture. As the mischief makers fled, the two boys outside fled, Mother Superior ordered everyone back to their positions and shot Sister Francesca a glare of her own. So, after that happened, calamity began claiming the nuns and the children, inflicting a severe headache on Artie, causing Dory McDowell, one of the kids in the class, causing her desk to collapse under her, and giving Eileen Duckworth, another girl in the class, a severe bout of nausea that made her throw up her breakfast right there in class. Sister Bernard Mary sent Artie and Eileen to the nurse, Sister Florence — yes, I got the name from Florence Nightingale — who treated them both. After lunch, Artie again braved the hostile bottle cap game players on the way to the Francis Scott Key Public Library, where he found a book on Italian folklore and read about the Malocchio and how to cure it. Sister Francesca, having already been scolded by Mother Superior, refused to help Artie when he asked her, but Artie returned to the home of the old Italian-speaking lady who he saw having that party with the ghosts to seek her help. And to Artie's surprise, the mischievous boys and their sister lived there with their parents and their elderly nonna, which is Italian for grandma. Artie introduced himself to their sister, Rosemary Fiasco, and asked her to introduce him to her grandmother, who was half insane, though she seemed to be perfectly communicative the night before when she had been intoxicated. And one aside, I'm going to show you what Fiasco means in Italian. This is a bottle of wine. There's actually wine in there. And this basket on the bottom of the bottle, that's called a fiasco in Italian. F-I-A-S-C-O, fiasco. But you might be familiar with the word fiasco, you know, meaning like a really troublesome situation. I'm not really sure the etymology of fiasco and fiasco. I'm sure there is some sort of etymological link, but I'm unaware of it. So if you know that etymological link, I'm a big fan of etymology, so drop it in the comments. I would love to know. But anyway, so I used the word fiasco, as the surname for this family because they were inspired by a family that lived on the street I grew up on in Southwest Philly. There were two boys, just like the two troublemaking boys in the story, and they had a sister, and this female character, the little girl here is inspired by their sister. And the whole family, they were a family of troublemakers. The kids were not nice kids. And I guess the adults in the family were a little strange too. I don't get the sense that they were like, you know, connected. They were just not nice people. And my grandmother used to call them the gypsies. She'd say the gypsy family. So I took the word fiasco, which means a calamitous situation, but is a bona fide Italian word and could certainly be a bona fide Italian surname. And I made it the surname of this fictitious family, the Fiasco family. So so Artie goes to the house. He introduced himself to Rosemary Fiasco, the sister, the little girl, and he asked Rosemary to introduce him to Nonna. And as he's in the house, as Rosemary was taking Artie to meet Nonna, the circular blue glass eye-like charm hanging from the chandelier, the Malocchio charm, continued to glare menacingly at Artie, who felt a malevolent spirit gazing into his soul from it. And I described it to the player, Rob, as that moment in The Lord of the Rings when the Eye of Sauron, you know, Frodo puts on the ring and the eye, and he sees the Eye of Sauron glaring at him, and it's like this terrible moment for Frodo. Well, that's how I described it for Artie. So Artie suggested, you know, he tried talking to Nonna, but Nonna was just gibbering. She was so old, she just lost her mind, and she wasn't even really aware of where she was at. But she seemed a lot more with it the night before at that nightly ghostly party that he had seen through the window, where she was drinking the family's homemade wine. So Artie suggested to Rosemary serving Nonna Fiasco some of the family's homemade wine. And Nonna, hearing that, perked up and eagerly concurred with the suggestion. So after a few drinks, Nonna seemed to be more aware, and Artie asked her for help removing a Malocchio curse that her grandson had put on the convent. So, you know, this is, I was kind of inspired, half inspired by the old drunken master trope, which I think Jackie Chan did a movie like that, where the martial arts character is, you know, he's not a good martial artist. You know, he may even be kind of like a wimp, and he gets bullied and beat up all the time. But when he's had a few drinks, he flops around and he does this floppy sort of martial arts style that just takes everybody out. It's funny, the drunken master. And I think that I recall watching an interview with George Lucas or a video in which George Lucas said that the Jar Jar Binks character, the much reviled Jar Jar Binks character, although I didn't really find Jar Jar too reviling, I hope I don't lose credibility by saying that, but that Jar Jar Binks' character was inspired by this this drunken master archetype. And so I kind of borrowed that for Nona. Nona is just like this, you know, she's this poor soul who's like suffering from dementia. She isn't really aware of where she's at until she has some of the family's homemade wine. And then when she gets intoxicated by the wine, she's a little bit more with it. And you can kind of get through to her. Yeah. So the bibulous octogenarian Nona agreed to help once she had a few drinks in her and was able to sort of understand the situation a little bit more. And Artie returned to the convent to retrieve a wheelchair from Sister Florence's nursing office to ferry Nona to the convent post-haste. So meanwhile, Rosemary Fiasco and the boys, Joey Fiasco and Anthony Fiasco, collected in a bag all of the items they'd need for the curse-removing ritual. Olive oil, salt, scissors, water, a bowl, and other such spell components. So they all hastened to the yard of the orphanage, where Nona instructed the boys they'd have to perform the ritual on the roof of the orphanage if the ritual were to affect all the people inside the orphanage. So the three boys climbed up the rain spout and hauled the bag of ingredients up with a rubber hose they had appropriated from the churchyard. And, you know, all of this stuff kind of reminds me of my childhood in the 70s and 80s. The rain spout, you know, there was that song, Itsy Bitsy Spider Climbed Up the Water Spout. And then if you watched Welcome Back, Cotter, the tagline, the insult that they often hurled at each other was, up your nose with a rubber hose. So, I don't know, it reminds me of that stuff. So so all of the boys, they get up to the top of the convent, having climbed up the rain spout. And Nona is down on the ground in her wheelchair, and Rosemary is sort of tending to Nona down on the ground. And Nona is calling up to the boys instructions to how to successfully dispel the Malocchio and save the orphans from further calamity. And that's where we ended the session. All of that basically lasted the entire evening, the entire session. And so the thrilling conclusion of that Malocchio story happens in episode 3. And fortunately, by that time, Beth is able to join us. So in episode 3, we not only tie up the Malocchio scenario, but we bring Beth's character, Cassie, or Hopalong Cassidy, into the story. So that was episode 2. That was session 2. And I hope you enjoyed that summary. And the next time we meet, we will meet Hopalong Cassidy, and we'll see how the Malocchio story plays out. All right. Well, I'll see you next time, and thanks for tuning in.